afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and neighbors, thank you very much for coming to our first inaugural State of the City address. My name is Tom Berry. I'm the city manager for the city of Minot. We'll first begin our event by posting the colors. Gentlemen.
Tom, thank you. Wow. Looking in the hallway and looking at the people here, it is like looking at the greatest leaders of the greatest city in North America. It is such an amazing thing to think of the things that we've been through together as a city, the things that we have faced together in the future that lays ahead. There's so many things to be proud of. Together we can be proud of the men and women of our city in this great place. I thank you for the honor to be a part of this with you, a part of this great city, and it is a joy to be a member of the city of Minot, North Dakota, with the greatest people in the world. Would you join your heart with mine in prayer? We come before God as we ask his blessings upon our evening tonight and the future that lays ahead. We join our hearts. This night, gracious Savior, we look to you and we thank you for each and every blessing that you have showered upon us. The blessing of great vision, the blessing of great leaders, the blessing of great families, the blessings of friendships and care, the blessings of meeting challenges and opportunities with the best that we have as they are gifts from you. We pray that you would be with each one this night, that you would give to us great courage and wisdom in all that lays ahead, that you would open up the venues for us as a city to be a place that is welcoming, a place that is caring, a place of opportunity, a place where families can find great benefit for their daily lives. Lord, so many good things have come, and so we ask that you would be with us and make this place a place that we are proud to call our home. Bless us now in your holy name, Lord Jesus, we pray, and all of God's people say, amen. Thank you, guys. Tom.
Thank you, Pastor Paul. I wanted to say... We'll try that again. I wanted to say a couple words of thanks, not only to the pastor, but also to many others who've pulled this event off for us. I want to thank Captain Scott Evans and the JROTC students for carrying our colors today, as well as the choir director, Lindsay Kersman, and the Change of Pace choir students, as well as the drummers, Mark Guyton Gleason and Tyler Smith, for sharing their talents with us today. Would you please join me in thanking them? Thank you. I also want to get a few more thanks out of the way. I certainly want to thank Principal Dr. Scott Fall and the Magic City Campus for their hospitality and for serving as our gracious hosts today. I also want to thank Trent Hall and Tracy Hartwig and their student teams for helping us with the audiovisual as well as the stage decoration. Thank you all very much. Lastly, I'd like to thank our community sponsors for their generosity and who will be sponsoring the social immediately following the event. They are as follows: Arnie's 2.0, Bones Barbecue, El Azteca, Marco's Pizza, the Trestle Tap House, and The Spot. We're very grateful for their contributions in today's activities as well. We have many leaders and dignitaries that are in attendance at today's event, and I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce and welcome them. Please hold your applause until all of them have been properly introduced. We'll start with the city council members. Council members, would you mind standing and remain standing as I call your name? President Mark Jantzer, Vice President Sean Sipma, Alderwoman Lisa Olson, Alderman Stephen Padragula, Alderman Shannon Strait, and Alderman Josh Wolski. Thank you for your guidance, your service, and your leadership. I'd also like to separately recognize our mayor, Mr. Chuck Barney, for his years of service to the city, which we'll talk about in just a few minutes. But Mayor, thank you very much for your service. I'd also like to ask our department directors to stand up, if you would, please. Don't be shy. Ladies and gentlemen, our city would not run were it not for the dedication and hard work of these leaders in our community. And I just want to tip my hat to you and thank you personally for all that you do for our city and for our administration. Thank you. This city wouldn't run without you. I really appreciate all that you do for us. We also have with us some members of the Ward County Commission, many state senators and congressmen, representatives from the United States Congress, as well as the governor's office, representatives from the Minot Air Force Base, Minot State University, and Minot Public Schools, a variety of local business leaders, local area leaders, and past elected officials, and last but not least, our hardworking and dedicated staff. Thank you all for your service. Thank you for your contributions to our nation, our great state, and our awesome community. This event, which is a first of its kind event for our city, offers us an opportunity to share with all of you the wonderful and exciting things that we're working on. It's part of our broader strategy to improve the accountability and transparency of our local government, and to also increase our engagement with our citizenry, as well as to celebrate our many, but often unknown, community accomplishments. I don't know about you, but I am very excited about our community. Despite our challenges, and there are a few, we have a bright and prosperous future ahead of us. And that's why I'm here, because I want to be a part of that future. I want to work with each and every one of you to bring that future to Minot. I've had the great privilege of serving as your city manager for just a little over a year now. And I want to thank you for accepting me and my family into your community. Thank you for your continued encouragement and support, and most of all, your friendship. At this time, I'd like to introduce our mayor. Mayor Chuck Barney is originally from the rural area of Western New York, graduating from Brockport High School near the shores of Lake Ontario. He graduated from Rochester Institute of Technology in 1979, and in 1981, he left Western New York to attend graduate school at Indiana University. He completed a Master's of Science degree in Instructional Systems Technology, and while at Indiana, he met Leslie Metz, a music student from Minot, North Dakota, and they married in 1983. The desire to be closer to family brought them to Minot in the summer of 1991. On January 9th, 2012, Chuck joined the Minot State University as director of the Severson Entrepreneurship Academy and the College of Business. Chuck has been on various boards, including president of the Chamber of Commerce, board member of MADC, district chairman of the Northern Lights Council of the Boy Scouts of America. In addition, he has served 3 terms as 4th Ward Alderman, 2 terms as City Council President, and 7 years as Finance Committee Chairman. He was elected mayor in June of 2014. Please welcome your mayor and my friend, Mr. Chuck Barney.
It's not squealing anyway, so we'll give it a go. Thank you all for coming tonight. This is great. This is a tremendous turnout, and I'm excited to do this. It wasn't my idea. I'll be upfront about that. It was not my idea, was it, Tom? No. But the more we talked about it, the more I thought this might be a good idea. Good idea for you to meet the city staff that serve you so well. Give you an idea to know what the city is doing, where we've been, where we are, and where we're going. So thank you all for taking the time to come out and listen to us and to interact with our staff. I think you'll be as impressed with them as I am. I also want to thank the JAROTC and Lindsay Kurzman's Change of Pace Singers. They did a marvelous job. And then again, that's our future right there. And them stepping up and doing such a wonderful job was great. And I also want to thank my friend Demetrius up there in the sound room that did all the sound and lights for us, worked late into the night last night to make sure this was going to work. I want to start off by talking a little bit about our history. not a lot, but just to give you an idea of where we've been. Because I think in a lot of respects, where we've been kind of frames where we are and where we're going. As most of you probably know, Minot started off as a railroad town. When the Burlington Northern came through here, they hit the winter. We just heard this story at the MADC meeting this afternoon. They got to the Gasman Coulee and decided to winter there. And Minot sprung up overnight, as if by magic, hence the Magic City. Minot was also fortunate enough to be selected as a county seat. That's the distant past. More recently, and I'm going to put it in the context of when the time I've been in elected office, which was in 2000. 2002, we had our first challenge, not our first challenge, but my first challenge in elected office, and that was a train derailment over by Teresito Vallejo. And it was a challenge for the city. It made us start looking at the resources that we have, the emergency resources, how we could become more resilient. And that played out in 2011 when we were working on the NDR grant, which was for the $74 million we got. They had a training course that was offered to cities that were competing. And in that course, they listed seven different disasters that city faced. Minot was two of those. I think that's really telling. Two of the disasters that FEMA was using as an example were from Minot. Obviously, the train derailment, but also the flood. During that time, Minot has focused on a lot of different issues. Some of them have been health-related. Minot was one of the first communities to limit smoking in public places. And we've established one of the best committees on addressing the opioid crisis that's facing our nation. And of course, we're doing it on a local basis. We've been very fortunate in that we have Minot Air Force Base just to the north of us. We've got a wonderful relationship with Minot Air Force Base. Mark Chancellor is head of Task Force 21. This week, right now, while we're here, they're up there, is the Air Force Global Strike Command, which is the command for both wings of our Air Force. And the commanding general said, I want to bring all of the management, all of the generals that work with these young people, and I want to take them to Minot. And I want to take them to Minot in January or February. Yeah, they're not laughing. And the reason why, I think, is really telling, because he wanted them to see, and more importantly, feel, the conditions in which our airmen and airwomen serve our country on a daily basis. He wanted them to go out onto the flight line when it's wind chill 25, 30 degrees below zero. He wanted them to go out to the missile silos and walk the perimeter. That's important for us. It's important for our community. It's important for our nation. Those people that are walking those flight lines, working on the flight line, they're also volunteering in our community. They spend many, many hours at the state fair volunteering. They're at the host fest providing security. They're part of our community. Not just are they part of our community in terms of what they're doing, but also financially. They're a tremendous economic impact to our community, and they're valued neighbors. Task Force 21, which Mark, I said, was the chairman of, is very busy making sure that the base is as relevant and successful as possible. Part of that mission is providing support for the re-engining of the B-52s, which will extend their lifeline another 30 years. I won't be here. But also, we're also looking at the ground-based nuclear deterrent, which is rehabbing the missile systems. And again, making sure that Minot Air Force Base stays very relevant going into the future. Where we've been, we had a population of just over 36,000 people in 2007 prior to the oil boom. In 2017, we estimate that that population is at 49,000. We've got many new businesses, Baker Hughes, Cameron Surface Systems, Hess, and many others. We have many new housing opportunities, apartments, 4,252 units built between 2007 and 2014. In 2011, the flood took away 25% of our housing stock. That was critical because at that time was when the oil boom was ramping up. We also had an expansion at the Air Force Base, and we had a housing shortage, and then we lost 25% of our housing stock. 500 cubic feet per second typically flows through the Souris River at that time of year. It was over 27,000 the day that we flooded. We're still recovering from that. We're recovering both physically and spiritually. Physically, we're making great inroads into rebuilding, and we're making inroads spiritually. And by spiritually, I mean that every spring, we get phone calls at the city and at my home, is the river going to flood? Regardless of how much rain or snow we have, we get those phone calls every year because the people are still worried. But we're going to work toward that. We're going to provide permanent flood protection so that we don't have to face that as a community again. And I think that's really important. The reason why I'm bringing all this up is that those events, I believe, frame where we're at and where we need to go. So that little bit of history is why I bring that up. One of my proudest moments living in Minot was right after the flood. We had 12,000 people who were displaced from their homes. At the peak of that, we had less than 300 people in shelters. Where did they go? They went out to you. You took them in. And I remember, I was an alderman then, I wasn't mayor, but I remember the FEMA people were absolutely astounded that Minot had only 300 people in shelters. Everybody else was in a home. Give yourself a round of applause. We still have challenges, and those challenges are falling commodity prices, falling oil prices, although we are starting to rebound from that a bit. We have state revenue loss, the reduced general fund at the state by $1.7 billion. And of course, that has to flow back to the people that were benefiting from it when times were good. City sales tax collections were down from 2000 to 2018, estimated to be about $18.2 million, down 33% from 2014. Excuse me. City revenue loss, the valuations on homes dropped 7%. The city mill levy went from 79 to 108. The population has continued to grow. We're up nearly 40% in the last decade, and the need for city services continues to grow. Landfill usage is up 79% between 2007 and 2016. We have 218 miles of waterline miles in 2007, and 324 of those miles in 2016. The number of calls for police and fire service is continually growing in 2007 from 31,900 to in 2017 we had 43,000 calls. So the services continue to grow and we continue to address them. The city's physical footprint has expanded from 9,600 acres to 17,750 acres. We have more streets to plow and maintain, 225 miles in 2007, excuse me, and 291 miles in 2017. Those are the few of the challenges that we faced in the past, but it kind of dictates where we are right now. But the future is bright, and nowhere is that future more bright than with our youth. We conducted a contest. And again, this was not my idea, but I thought it was brilliant. Tom and Janet, where's Janet? Janet's here someplace, the librarian. There you are. I don't know which one of you came up with it, but it was absolutely brilliant. And that was to have an essay contest with our fifth graders. And I got to tell you, I learned a lot. I learned a lot of things I didn't know, and a lot of things I probably should have known. And one of the, there's a few of them that I just want to share with you, and then I'm going to bring the winner of the writing challenge up here. But I learned that one of the best things about living in Minot is that we don't have tarantulas. And I assured that young man that we will not form a committee to consider it. Is that right, Shannon? All right. I learned that the young people love hockey, they love skating, they like going to the trampoline park. But what all I learned, what I took from all of that, is that they don't avoid the cold, they embrace it. They embrace our weather. And I think that's perfect, because what we have here is a quality of life that sometimes gets cold. But they've learned to deal with it, they've learned to embrace it, and they've learned to love it. 135 essays were submitted. That's an awful lot. I was really impressed by that. We narrowed it down to 13, and then I took those 13, and I pored over them, I went over them, I sorted them, I read them many, many times, and it was a very difficult decision. But I came up with one, and I'd like to introduce right now the winner of the mayor's writing challenge, and that's Grayson Schaefer. Come on up, Grayson.
Why I love calling Minot my home. I love Minot for many reasons. There are exciting adventures waiting to occur. It feels safe and welcoming to people who come here. The first thing I would like to talk about is the outstanding university that is available. Minot State offers great education, especially for art and teaching. The campus is also nice with maps to direct you on where you need to go. There are many classes to take at all times in the day. Next, Minot also hosts the North Dakota State Fair and the Norse Coast Fest. They are big hits and welcome people from across the nation. Kids also enjoy these events. The fair offers not only great rides and food, but also a ginormous art gallery with art made by the students of Minot. The Husfest offers great food as well and opportunities to learn about the Scandinavian heritage. These two events are part of the many family-friendly activities that Minot offers. Minot offers parks to play in or relax in. We offer theaters for shows, movies, and plays. We offer museums for art, planes, railroads, and more. Minot offers much more, including a trampoline park, sports complexes, the YMCA, mini golf, escape rooms, and more. Minot also has a great hospital and clinics. The hospital is open 24 hours and accepts any emergencies. They also take really good care of their patients. An advantage about the hospital is the location of it. It is in the center of Minot, so emergencies can come from any direction and have a somewhat short travel. Also, the clinics are walk-ins and accept any minor illnesses or injuries. Next, Minot has a newly constructed airport that is huge and modern. They fly planes in and out of Minneapolis, Las Vegas, and Denver. It has nice gates, security, and a car rental station. We are lucky to have these places, but there's more. Minot offers outstanding education. The education is possible because of the outstanding teachers. Especially my teacher, because she pushes us to our limits, she cares about everyone, and wants to make us better in every subject. With the great education, there are great job openings and opportunities. One of my favorite activities is sports. My favorite sport is basketball. Minot offers great opportunities for sports. There's a recreation system that runs a league for baseball, basketball, softball, volleyball, and other sports too. Another feature Minot has is the restaurants. There are fast food restaurants, delivery restaurants, and sit-in restaurants. The employees do a great job of cooking for people and serving people. Two of my favorite restaurants are Homesteaders and Olive Garden. They both have delicious food and well-trained employees. Next, Minot has a public library. The library is open to anyone who wants to study, read, or go on a computer. Also, the internet is free to use there. Last, Minot has good people who make it a great city. The people also make the pollution and crime rates low. I am proud to live in the great city of Minot, and I am proud to call it my home. There isn't a reason I would want to leave because I've lived here my whole life. I have made many memories here and I love it. Thank you.
Grayson, wait a second. Get a standing ovation. Take this. Good job. Grayson, I have something here for you that is a military tradition that I learned when I was, since being mayor, that we have a, they have commander's coins. So I have a mayor's coin, and I want to give that to you for a job well done.
Thank you.
You bet. I'll also point out that Tom Berry doesn't have one. Jury's still out. Thank you, Grayson, for that. You did a marvelous job. Now we want to talk a little bit about where Minot is now. We've got challenges in front of us, budget challenges, sales taxes down. We've talked about it. The state ended our 12% property tax relief, 108 mills this year, and $141 million budget in 2018. Difficult challenges. Flood protection, though, is moving forward. We are going on March 28th. Yes, thank you. We are going to be breaking ground with our congressional delegation for the first three phases of flood protection in Minot. That's a huge deal. It's been a long time coming. A lot of people have put in a lot of hard work. We've had some tremendous partners at the federal level with our congressional delegation. We've had tremendous support from the North Dakota legislature, and I would personally like to thank them. Now, please stand, the legislators, senators and legislators, please stand up and be recognized for the hard work that you have done on our city's behalf in getting us permanent flood protection through CLAP. We are very grateful for that because it was a lot of work, a lot of heavy lifting to make sure that Minot is getting to where we're at with flood protection. To give you an idea of the budgeting that's involved there, we were fortunate that the first phase is $43 million, but it's $15 million below budget, $15 million below the engineer's estimate. Phases two and three are $35.7 million, and they're also $5 million below the engineer's estimate. The reason why that's important is that that $20 million can now be used for phases down the road. And that's very, very important because we are really looking hard at where we're going to get that money from. Phase four, what we call the Maple Diversion, is currently in the design phase, and we believe we've got the financing in place to complete that. But the and when those first four phases are completed, understanding that we're breaking ground in March in the first three, 60% of the city will have flood protection. That doesn't mean we're going to forget the other 40%. We're working very hard to make sure the entire city is going to have permanent flood protection. The other thing that we've been doing, we've been working really hard on is the National Disaster Resilience. If you might remember, we won a competition with the federal government and we were awarded $74 million to help improve the city. There were some caveats. I want to remind this to all of our legislators that it does not include permanent structures for flood protection, but it does address a lot of our other needs. It allows for the downtown gathering space, which many of you have been involved with. It includes the Resilient Neighborhoods Program, affordable housing for underserved populations, a decision support tool, property acquisitions for the green space, a family shelter, relocating City Hall. This past week, with the help from Senator Hoeven's office, FEMA was in town to help us identify funding sources for the later phases, five through eight. In in those meetings, we had FEMA, of course, but we also had FIMA, which is the Federal Insurance Mitigation Administration. We had representatives from the city, of course. We also had, representatives from Ward County. We had Army Corps of Engineers was there, USDA Rural Development, USDA was there, and US Department of Transportation. So they're gonna help us find the additional monies that we need to complete the other phases. Anybody hear anything about garbage automation? I've had a few phone calls. As you know, we switched over to automated garbage collection this past year, and it is the first step towards recycling. We had overwhelming support from the public on recycling in our community, and this is the first step. The other thing it allowed us to do is become more efficient with our funds and our budgeting, and reduce the number of full-time equivalent people that are on the trucks by 9. The other thing that's important to understand about that is that, interestingly enough, the garbage truck is the most dangerous position in the city of Minot, if you look in terms of workers' comp claims. And to make sure that our city employees are working in a more safe environment is critical. We have a lot to do here. We have food trucks. We have art shows. We have craft shows. We have wine walks. We have a new children's museum that's under works to get built. We have outdoor activities like Grayson was talking about. We have hockey, and we have many facilities where we can do those. We have first-rate, world-class facilities in the city of Minot. The municipal auditorium, the MSU dome, and the new air-supported dome, which was built with help from the city, gives people year-round activities that they can go in and enjoy their particular sports. We have the All Seasons Arena. We have Mason Arena, which is just a jewel in our community. I want to thank Ron Merritt and the Park Board for all the support and help that they've done for our community. Corbett Field has new artificial turf. The South Hill and Saratoga Sports Complexes has 2 new turf fields, and the Jack Hovind Complex has a new turf, and we can't forget Wee Links Golf Course. MSU is near and dear to my heart. Although I didn't go to school there, my wife did, and both my children did, and I work there now. It has a great financial impact on the community, almost $200 million in 2015. It's a tremendous asset to us financially, but also more importantly, I think it's a tremendous asset for us culturally. They provide a lot of the cultural aspects that Minot is famous for, whether it's music, whether it's plays, like The King and I, or anything else. Minot State is a wonderful asset to our community. They also are a pipeline of talent for our community. Whether you're in business, like me, and Tanya, I saw you in here someplace, teaching, many of our teachers come out of Minot State, speech pathology or any other major, we can school our young people and hopefully have them stay in our community. Minot Public Schools, what great partners they are. They allowed us to do this here tonight, and I'd like to thank Dr. Fall and Dr. Vollmer for the tremendous cooperation that they've allowed us to do this tonight. They have dedicated and passionate teachers and staff. I married one. She told me to say that. don't tell her I said that. And there's a tremendous asset when MADC, Stephanie's here someplace, when MADC recruits businesses, one of the first things they check out are the educational opportunities for their employees if they're going to relocate to a new location. One of the things that kind of sprang up on us last summer was the opioid epidemic that's facing our nation. And we have a very local problem here that we're trying to address as a city council and as a city. We formed a committee in 2017, or I formed one, it's the Mayor's Committee on Addiction. And I wasn't sure exactly how to address this, so I included a lot of people, which I don't usually do for committees. I typically like to form small committees, but this one I felt like had to be a large committee so that we had enough representation from the different elements of the community that deals with this problem, and to make sure that we had people that were facing the problem on the committee to get their perspective. I've got, I hope I don't forget anybody, I probably will, but I do know that Alderman Strait is on the committee and Alderman Padragula is on the committee. Alderman Padragula is a clinical psychologist, so he brings not only the community perspective, but also the clinical psychologist perspective. We have the Sheriff Bob Barnard is on the committee. Chris Ray, the jailer, head jailer, is on the committee. Dr. Vollmer is on the committee. Dr. Sather from Trinity is on the committee. We have three different groups of parents that have faced this issue in their own life that are on the committee. We have Lisa Klute from First District Health is on the committee. We have Steve Hall from Parole and Probation is on the committee. We have a lot of other people. And the reason why I made this committee so big was so that we could look at that issue in its entirety. And that was fortunate on our part that we did it that way, because when we met with the state to talk about the funding, the funding opportunities that may be in the state level, they told us that we should look at this issue comprehensively. We shouldn't look at one particular solution and try to fix that. We need to look at the problem from beginning to end and everything in between, and that's what we did. And when we did that, we broke the committee up into subgroups. Those subgroups took their areas of expertise or interest and went deep on it. They came back, they presented a paper to the main committee, and the main committee is taking that, and Paul Strokland, one of the parents that are involved, they're taking that paper, and we're going to turn it into a comprehensive white paper. And we're hoping that that white paper will identify the roadblocks and gaps for treatment within our community. And then I plan on disbanding this committee and forming a new one that will be independent of the mayor's office and allow them to run with that and to find solutions for the items that they've identified. So the work of getting rid of the problem isn't ending, but we're getting down into the trenches with it. I think that's critical. To get a grasp on this, North Dakota is one of the fastest growing state for opioid deaths in the U.S. We need to fix that. We need to figure out a way of combating that problem, and I think we're on the right path. We've had an interesting year with my peers. We had a change in government, which was fascinating for me. Not just fascinating for me because I was in the middle of it, but it was fascinating for me because it was so interesting to watch how it evolved and how it changed and how it just grew and morphed into what we have today. We went from 14 aldermen to 6. We went from a non-voting mayor to a voting mayor. We had some hiccups, nothing major. We had some challenges, we got through them. And we had to go through the process of restructuring our committees and finding ways of continuing the city's business under this new form of government. I think we've done a good job. Thank you to you guys for helping us get through it. We also have some ratings to share from our fire protection. We've been raised to a class 2, which means that your property, not your property taxes, but your fire insurance for your homes gets lower because of the impact of that rating. The insurance companies use that to rate your community. And we're only one of 1,300 fire departments in the nation that's achieved that. So thank you, Chief Flerman, for your hard work and all the hard work of your staff, and make sure they understand our appreciation. Minot is enrolled in the FEMA Community Rating System, the CRS, and we are at a level 8. Class 8, which means that all of the people that are going to be required to have flood protection insurance get a 10% discount. And Lance Meyer has been the spearhead of that, and I want to thank him for it. And I know that we're working to even improve that further. Nas was here before I was elected in 2000, and it'll be here when I leave this year. But we're making progress. The lawsuits that were brought to by Missouri and Manitoba were dismissed. The water treatment plant in Max, which has become a requirement, is in the design phase, and the project is resuming after 20 years of litigation. Minot's Public Library, Build Minot Program, Janet did that, thank you. It was a remarkable event where we had 3,591 building blocks where people wrote down what they liked about the community, what they'd like to see. And it's been a real asset and also a great opportunity for people to be able to let their elected leaders know what the priorities are for them. One of those ideas that came out was recycling. I think that was the number one issue of all the people that responded. Walkability, helping at-risk populations, new restaurants and businesses, recreation, beautification, and public safety were kind of rounded out the list. I want to thank again our congressional delegation for all of their support with helping us secure flood protection, and also the role they play in securing the future of Minot Air Force Base. Where we are, update on Minot Air Force Base, we talked about that a little bit, and I just want to highlight a couple of things that the financial impact this year for Minot Air Force Base is $580 million to the community of Minot. That's a significant number. We would be in a much different place without that relationship that we have with the Air Base. Vice President Mike Pence was up there, and I think that speaks to the importance of the base. The fact that there's two legs of the nuclear triad make it a very relevant and important base, particularly in today's world. The Secretary of the Air Force, in the short time that she's been Secretary of the Air Force, has been here twice. The one before that was here five different times. And I already mentioned that the Air Force Global Strike Command is here as we speak. Several of the people that have gone through the leadership program at Minot Air Force Base in terms of being wing commanders or group commanders have gone on to better things. Last week, I had the opportunity to go to F.E. Warren Air Force Base to observe the changing of command for the 20th Air Force. There's two of them, 20th and 8th, I get them confused. 20th Air Force, where General Tony Cotton, who married a girl from Valpa when he was here before, or long time before, relinquished command of the 20th Air Force and relinquished it to Fred Stoss, who is also a Minot alum. And so for two times in a row, the commander of the 20th Air Force is a Minot alum. That speaks highly of the caliber of people they send up here and of the experiences they have. Later that same afternoon, General Cotton went from being a two-star general to a three-star general. So, and he talks fondly about Minot and coming up here to visit his in-laws on a regular basis. Minot Air Force Base is a symbol of what Minot means to the state, the region, and the country. And City Council President Mark Janser, who is also a member of Task Force 21, can speak more about that. Mr. Janser. I'm going to probably just stand over here so I don't squeal. I hope.
Thank you, Mayor Chuck. Good afternoon. I'm going to speak about another kind of symbol. For hundreds of years, almost since the beginning of the first organized human societies, people have developed flags to symbolize who and where they are and what they represent. whether clans, cities, states, military units, or religions, unique flags have been created, flown, and carried to represent the organization. Many of us first learned the Pledge of Allegiance in early elementary school as part of our daily routine. Today, we start each city council meeting with that same pledge. Whether reaching the summit of a mountain or landing on the moon, a flag is the symbol of accomplishment and presence. In the military especially, whether on the battlefield or at important ceremonial actions such as changes of command, like Chuck attended, our nation's stars and stripes, as well as unit flags and general officers' personal flags, play key symbolic roles. In addition, flags have grown to symbolize rallying points in times of threat or disaster. It's easy to recall the proliferation of U.S. flags being flown and worn in support of our country's resilience and resolve after 9/11. Love of country is many times visually synonymous with respect and love for our nation's flag. With flags playing such an important role in civic life, it was surprising that as far as we could find, our city has never flown its own flag. That is, until today. This flag symbolizes the strength, unity, and resilience of our city and is meant to inspire service, dedication, and citizenship. It will be flown with pride at City Hall and other municipal facilities to remind us each and every day why our town truly is magical. I would like to ask the other members of the City Council to join the mayor and I on stage to help unfurl and post the City of Minot's flag for the very first time.
Thank you, Mark. All right, you sit down. It's an honor to be a part of today's first ever State of the City event and the unveiling of our new city flag. We've talked about where we've been, where we're at, and now I'd like to talk a little bit about where we're going. The events of our past have made Minot what it is today. City that residents proudly call home, a city of residents working to secure their future, a city of residents committed to educating their children, a city full of entrepreneurs and businesses looking to form their way in life, a city where residents choose to live, work, play, and stay. Minot is our home. I think that's your cue, Demetrius, or somebody. Well, a funny thing happened on the way to the State of the City address. We have a short video that we want to show you, and then we'll wrap this up. But I can say that while we're waiting for that to happen, Back in 2011, Principal Jim Cheddar, when the Ramstead was destroyed by the flood, said, "Buildings don't make schools, people make schools." And to paraphrase that a little bit, buildings and streets don't make communities, the people do. So thank you all for making Minot the blessed community that it is. Now we have that short video, I think, and I will pull this back.
An oasis between America's amber waves of grain, peppered with picture-perfect parks and built for the bustling life in the Bakken, there's never been a better time to live in the city of Minot. Beyond its natural beauty, the city of Minot is renowned for safe communities and a growing footprint. The city continues to invest in these communities and in the future by restoring miles of pipes and roadways, leveraging state and federal dollars and other partnerships to build up our bridges, improve our quality of life, and revitalize our business districts. All of which is making the city of Minot a more resilient, vibrant, and safe city. Our law enforcement has built a community perfect for any family or any person to call home.
455.
The fire department invests time and effort into fire safety and prevention. In fact, the city of Minot is investing millions to protect residents from all types of risks and dangers, ensuring continued growth and future prosperity. Pair all of this with highly rated schools, parks, successful businesses or developments, and it still doesn't scratch the surface of what Minot has to offer. Name a career. It's here. The economy in Minot is diverse and active, and it allows for nearly any career path for the striving professional. Our neighbors to the north, the Minot Air Force Base, plays a key role in this for our city. By luring highly skilled individuals from all over the nation, the best truly do come north. The area is most commonly known for the energy and agriculture sectors. These keystones help to recruit and retain a dynamic workforce and remains a major driving force for the rest of the local economy. A major university, a regional hospital, and the ever-expanding private sector continues to blossom and yields bigger and better opportunities year after year. Here in the Magic City, the sky is the limit. While Minot has a great professional atmosphere, things still can get pretty wild. Flush with entertainment and loads of recreational opportunities, there's rarely a dull moment. From arts to dining, shopping, or our all-season activities, letting loose is simple. Just a short drive to several lakes and you're one with nature. The hunting is robust. Golf, well above par. And even when the temperature falls, the fun never hibernates. Traditions are a pillar for our community. Thousands collect in Minot each year for our major events. It's the home of the North Dakota State Fair, the Norsk Hust Fest, rodeos, craft shows, the beautiful symphony, the Nodak Speedway, and dozens of all types of events bring people in droves to our community. When it comes to entertainment, Minot really does knock this out of the park. In Minot, family is the foundation, traditions are our treasure, and business is booming. That's allowed us to build a safe, healthy, and vibrant community. Just look around. It's truly easy to see why Minot continues to bring only the best north and is the ideal place to live, work, play, and stay.
Thank you to Derek Hackett and Brian Obenchain for that. Brian's the public information officer, and he put that together. We have accomplished much as a city, but we have a lot of work ahead. We are committed to moving our community forward. We are committed to completing the downtown parking structures, working with the developers to find a resolution that is mutually beneficial. I want to stress that for a minute. We are going to find a solution that is in the best interest of Minot and put that behind us. The city is holding back funds until all the issues are resolved with them. We are committed to flood protection for our entire city. We are committed to becoming an even more resilient community, and we are committed to the safety of our community, particularly through our first responders. I want to talk about that for just a second before I wrap up. Chief Flerman and Chief Olson, please stand. If you've ever, you have to, I'm like still the mayor. I want to say that if you've ever been in any distress, and I have, and you're there alone, but you hear the siren, and you hear the siren getting louder and louder and louder, you know it's good, because you know they're coming. Thank you. We are committed to finishing up NAWS, and we are committed to being fiscally responsible and transparent, even when the microphone doesn't work. We are committed to economic development and diversifying our economy. We are committed in investing in agriculture. We are committed to continued investment in our downtown, the heart and soul of our community. And we are committed to maintaining and improving the quality of life that we have here. I'm going to tell you a very brief story that kind of makes me look bad, but I'm not running again, so I don't really care. 35 or 36 years ago, I met my wife in Bloomington, Indiana. And we dated and got engaged. She brought me to North Dakota for the first time. It was a shock. While we were engaged, I lived in Chicago. I worked for a public accounting firm there. She came back here and was a music teacher in Carpio. Being from New York, I tend to be a little bit direct. And back then, you may be a little bit cocky, right? Maybe, I don't know. But I told That's enough out of you. No. But because I was maybe a little bit cocky and a little bit direct, I told her very straightforward so that she understood before we got married, I would never live in North Dakota. But things change. The things that were appealing to Chicago or St. Louis or Atlanta, where we lived after that, paled in comparison to what we have here. Quality of life. To the point that I moved my mother here, which... but I did. And she lived here for nearly 20 years because of the people and the quality of life and the values that exist in this community. And that's why I'm proud to be your mayor. Thank you. I screwed it up.
Thank you very much, Mayor. At this time, that concludes the formal presentation. We'd like to invite all of you down to the cafeteria just at the end of the hall to enjoy a social hour with us. We have many of the sponsors there awaiting your arrival, and we hope that you'll enjoy what you see there and continue the conversation with us. Thank you very much for coming today. We very much appreciate it.